Hey and welcome. So I know I did a quick unboxing, which I didn't know much at the time, but as you can see, we got all the components out and we've been going through the rule book here. And so my son Jason has graciously agreed to join me, and we're going to do a scenario here that's a small scenario that's just the war between Germany and Russia. So thank you. So we're going to go ahead and do that. Now, my disclaimer here. First of all, if you want to see just the playthrough, jump to the next video. I'm going to go through setup real quick for this scenario. Jason and I definitely want to do the global scenario where we do all seven nations in the game. What we're doing is we're doing this because we're trying to learn the rules, right? So we did a quick read. There's a lot of stuff that I know I read once, but I'm going to have to go back and look at again. So I'm going to give this disclaimer right away, especially after somebody on Board Game Geek complained about it. We're showing you a game where we are learning to play. So we will potentially get things wrong. We will potentially do things we weren't supposed to do. We're not necessarily going to make good strategic decisions. But the purpose of my channel is you're here to join me at the table. So you can learn with us and you can be a part of this with us. We're not trying to exclude you. And I am not a one-stop co-op shop. I am not gonna sit here and polish my videos and prepare for you something that's completely scripted and all that stuff. That's just not what I do. So I think most of you who watch my videos already know this. It's just for whatever reason, there's been an influx of new people and they just don't get it. So I had to give this little disclaimer and my apologies there, but I just want you to understand what you're getting into. Now, if you want a polished game, wait for our second playthrough because Jason and I are going to do the global campaign and we promise you we're not gonna do that until we've learned all of our rule lessons from this. So what you're gonna see, I mean, War Room literally arrived in the mail this afternoon and we're just 3 or 4 hours removed from it being taken out of the box. So you're seeing us play this on our first night and getting wet and all that other stuff with it. So I hope I make sense. We're not trying to con you or anything. We're trying to be as upfront and honest about this as possible. And when we do the global one, so if you're looking at this playthrough, and you're like, oh, that's not for me. I want to see the more polished game. You're going to have to wait until we go to the global because we can't promise you that this one's going to be polished. We're going to stop. We're going to check rules. We're going to do all that stuff while we play this. And if that's not for you, then don't watch. And this message is just for that particular person on Board Game Geek. I have never, ever asked you to like or subscribe to any of my videos. It's not what I'm here for. I am not a person trying to make money off of these videos. I am a person who loves to play games, and I welcome you to join us.
You know, I can vouch for that, but I know I have said like and subscribe.
Yeah, you have. I haven't. You did that during Dinosaur Island, yeah. I think. Yeah. So my son has asked you to like and subscribe, but I haven't. Yeah. So we're just a family that loves to play games. We're welcoming you to join us. It's nothing more than that. I think you guys are so used to corporate video people who are doing unboxings because they're quick and easy to do, and then they're asking you to like and subscribe, and they rake in the dough. That's not what we're here for. So, and perhaps I should just do a separate video that says what the goal of my YouTube channel is. I don't do those kind of things, but maybe I should, and we should explain that. But anyways, I'm gonna stop ranting, and let's get to the game. So to set up this game, a couple of things. The first thing is, oh my gosh, there's so many things. So you're gonna have tokens that look like this, and they're gonna be different colors. And your guide for that will be this morale board here. So here you can see Russia is like a red. Italy is like a light green. Germany is gray. America is a dark green. I'm sorry, this wasn't Russia, this is Japan. This is Japan. Russia's the red up here. Japan's like a yellow. So for example, that is Japan. And this, the beige here, is Britain, which is way up at the top, the United Kingdom. This this green, which isn't to be confused with, so there's two greens here, right? So you got two types of green. This one has a lot less pieces in it. That's Italy. And then this, well, actually, it might be the other way around. America might actually have less pieces. Well, we'll have to figure it out, because as you can tell, I have not opened these yet. So, but trust me, one's one and the other one's the other. Now, how will we know which one's which? So, like, if you're guessing, the stickers that come with the game, basically, one sticker is going to go into each of those pieces. And you can see that we peeled stickers away for Germany and Russia, because those are the only two that are in this scenario. We also, as you can see, haven't even opened this yet, which has control markers for them. There's a lot of stuff. Now, I can tell you the gold may seem confusing, but this one's China. And you can sort of see it up there. China is gold. And the black ones are confusing. Those are for the national colors. And those ones are used for the turn order track and the diplomacy track. So you use the black ones for those. And then there's these white ones that we are guessing. The rule book doesn't explain what color does what. This very much looks like neutral. So we think that the neutral countries use these. The neutral countries are involved in this game, unlike, you know, Axis and Allies. So then the next thing that we do is in the back, starting on page 25, are the scenarios. You have to pick your scenario. So here's the global scenario, and you can see that all seven nations are involved. And depending on the player count, they give you the distribution of nations. I know somebody suggested they may never have more than two people. Well, if you're two people, one person plays all the Allied nations, one person plays all the Axis. I can't tell you how cumbersome that is. I mean, Jason and I are going to find out. We're going to try it. And then my son, Josh, is actually going to possibly join us. We're not sure. He's sort of half in, half out. Well, it'll all depend on the day. So there's also war in Europe, war in the Pacific. And then what you're going to see we're doing is the Eastern Front. Okay, obviously in the Eastern Front, there's only two nations. And so then you have this, like, it's just a picture of the map that's used for this scenario. And the only thing that stinks about this is you have to eyeball it. So for example, I'm going to pick on Germany here. Germany, see, like, here, it's gray, it's like whited out. Denmark is whited out, and then Norway and Finland are whited out. And so that means that Norway doesn't have anything, and neither does Denmark. And also, you may have noticed that France was blotted out as well. So we don't have anything in France, etc. But normally Germany would in a global game. And so here you can see there's a lot of presence in Africa, and Africa is completely eliminated. So the first thing you have to do is figure out, you know, what is in and what is out. So what does that mean? You know, what does it mean that some are in and some are out? Well, so what we did is we took the German tokens, which were gray, and we went through the stickers, and all the circle stickers go in the circles, all the square stickers go in the square, and then all the oblong stickers go in the oblong. It's really simple there. So this represents Navy. The square represents ground units. And the circles represent air units. And of course, I'm throwing things around everywhere. Okay. Now, some of these stickers, like here, you'll see that it says G3. See how it says G3 there? G stands for Germany. So that gives you a general idea. And you can see G3 is France. So France has a strategic value of 6. And that's also represented by 6 smokestacks. So see those smokestacks there? There's 6 of them. And then the 2 and the 3 represents iron and other strategic resources. So you can see here, there's oil, which is red, iron blue, and then brown is other strategic resources. And then there's the Russia one for Jason. So France would be producing that many resources if it were in the game. But for this scenario, I'm playing Germany, right? Yeah. So for this scenario, France is out, so we don't get those resources. So this is a really cool thing, and you can see here that, see on the right side there, there's two yellow blips, and then three blue, and then two green. So what you would do is, since these are land units, here's the three blue, which are artillery, two yellow, which are the infantry, and then one tank, which is the green. And actually two tanks, I'm sorry. And then what you do is you make a stack of that, and then this goes on top of that stack. So this would represent France. And this is called one unit in France. And then this is a command marker, and it's very important that you get the command markers on every stack. And you can see we have command markers on every stack out here. And I'm assuming it's right. I mean, we didn't screw that up, did we? I don't think we did. So now I happen to have extra ones. And Jason, I think I need your help with this. So like, is that in? I think that's out, right?
Oh.
Because we started setting in the West, we started setting up for global folks, and then we changed our minds. So
this is out.
Yeah, just take out everything that's out. Okay. He's been a very good helper, so thank you. All right, so we took out everything that's out, and so here's our situation. And is this the neutral?
Yes.
So, arguably speaking, neutral.
It's a 2v1 in this situation.
You know, neutral would get a white cap on it to show that that's a neutral. We still haven't figured this out yet because, like, we don't understand what the point is of putting that white cap on. Because normally these numbers mean something and they're very important. So stay tuned on that. We may have to change our story there. So the next thing you do is there's these little cards. So for example, I have Mexico here, right? So these are little cards. They look like this. And there's one for every territory. Or land territory in the game. I don't think there's any, because you can never control. Yeah, let me zoom out a little here. So Jason's going to show you that he has this little board, and show him how the cards slide in and out.
They just slide in and out of.
So there's this little lip here that they just slide into. And so what you do is you take every territory that you have, and they're all named here. So R10 is on the board somewhere. Can you find R10 real quick? There's R9. Yeah, there's R10. So let me zoom in there, and you can see R10 is on the board. Everything on the board is labeled. Okay, so let's go back to the cards. So Jason has so many territories that it fills up his whole tableau, and then he has another one, and that's what these black ones are for. They're for extra, and you can see he has two extra cards.
This is hard.
It's okay. You got it. So what Jason now has to do is, you can see on the cards, it shows their production values. So you don't have to look on the board. But this is the same number that you would see on the board. You can use either way. And then what he did was he added up all the red, all the blue, and then all the yellow. So then show us your pegboard there. So he then has, you know, he's starting the game with six oil, six iron, and 11. OSR stands for Other Strategic Resources.
Like,
okay, so
and food.
One other thing to also see is they did this little marker here, so you can see how it's shaded. So when you're playing the global game, the shaded value is your starting number, so you don't even have to add them up. Now, in this particular scenario, Jason is using all of his tokens, his global tokens. I, however, am not. As you saw, I don't have France, I don't have Norway, I don't have Denmark. And so here you can see I have an unshaded line that goes through, and that's where I start. And then here you can see the shaded lines if I actually had all my territories. So you can see the starting positions for both. Now, when you play just Europe only or Pacific only, I'm not even sure Germany's in the Pacific campaign. And then, of course, in the Europe one, it's probably all of Germany. So so they do that. It's a really handy and helpful. So for this particular scenario, that's how it's set up. The other thing is every nation gets its own book.
No, the Soviet Union's better.
So he's got the Soviet Union book. And I'm going to open it up real quick. And up here is going to be like a nice player aid for your movement values, which are extremely helpful. I mean, they all seem to make sense. Then there's neutral trading. You can trade with neutral territories. I confess with you, we haven't read those rules yet. So we got to go look that up still. And then morale penalties is something that happens to you because there's a morale track there in the middle, and you can actually lose morale as you lose battles. So that's a new thing in this game that, you know, wasn't in Axis and Allies, and so we're definitely going to have to get on top of that. The way this game works is you're going to write commands here, and you can command up to 9 units. And then what happens is Jason's going to be writing in this book secretly. And at the same time, I'm going to be writing in my book. We're going to do it simultaneous. The rule book says you can put a time limit if you have annoying players who take too long.
Like you.
you can do that. And then what you're going to do is at the top, you're going to write the location. So, for example, if I'm moving a unit from Greater Germany here, which is G1, and I'm moving into France, which is G3, I would write G1 on the top, and I would write G3 below the arrow, because below the arrow is where they're moving to. And we'll get into more of that when we start playing, but there's some pretty cool things. So, like, for example, if I want to split this stack up into two because I want to move half of it this way and the other half that way, I would have to actually announce to Jason that I'm splitting the stack. And if I split the stack, each split would take up its own square. And like I said, you can only do 9 commands. So you can't just split everything up and have 100 commands. But I could split this up and tell him I have to announce it while we're secretly writing. I can't announce it after we do the reveal.
I'm not even sure how that would work, though. Because right now you already have, right now, not 9, but...
Speak up.
So you have like G1 here.
Yeah.
This is what you're talking about. This is one unit, right?
That's one unit, yes.
And then we have in Germany up to already 9. We got through 9 over here and all of these areas. But then you got Norway, which is G10. How would that work?
Oh, okay. So you're saying I already have more than 9 units. Yeah. So I'm only allowed to move 9.
Oh, so only move 9? Oh.
I'm only allowed to do actions with 9. So you're right. I have more than 9, so I'm going to have to pick which 9 I want to activate. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay. So the other thing is, let's say I split this. And I have no idea why I would split it, but let's say I'm going to split it like into one stack of 1 and then this other mega stack here. There's spare of these. This is a spare unit, and you'll notice it doesn't have a starting location. This is just an extra one I have, so I can... Every stack, every unit always has a command number, because you got to write the numbers down in your secret book in order to be able to justify what it is that you were trying to do. So we, that's how that's going to work. And the the other part of this is there's this thing called, and I know I'm getting into a little bit of the rules here, but there's this thing called pinning. And so what pinning means is, let's say this whole stack is going to attack Russia here in the Caucasus. Okay?
That's where my oil is. Get out.
So let's say I want to attack there. But Jason had a move order where he was moving, God only knows, let's say he was just moving up here. Or let's say he was even going to attack me, right? We were going to mutually attack each other. Well, this is where turn order comes in. And what pinning means is if I go first... I'm moving in this stack. He has to have as many units as I have and leave them in this territory to basically defend the territory. If he has more units than me, then those extra units above and beyond what I have, they are forced to move. The other ones have to stay, but then the extra ones move. So he's not going to get the outcome he was originally...
So I could technically take your territory. If you don't move any more units into this territory.
Well, you don't have as many units as I do, though.
Well, yeah, so saying that I would have, let's say, this army on top of that, I move, like, half of it into here, and you don't move anyone else into Ukraine, I could take that territory just for free?
Technically, yes.
Oh, man, that's awesome.
Well, I mean, the thing is that's a turn order thing, right?
Yeah.
Because if I'm here and you go first, then I'm going to be able to defend that territory before you even go, right? Yeah. So now, how does turn order work in this game? And of course, these stacks are really, they're a cool idea, but they are, they're a little flimsy. Okay, so turn order has to do with something else. Can you bring your booklet back over?
Yes.
So when it's our turn, Jason's going to secretly write up to 9 commands. And just so you know, China only gets like 6 commands and Italy only gets 6. Like some countries don't get the full 9. The United States don't get the full 9 if you're doing a smaller scenario, like just Pacific only. But anyways, what we do is we also secretly write an oil bid. And so Jason, for example, starts with 6 oil and I start with 4 oil. If he bids 5 oil, because that's all he has to bid, he's going to guarantee that he goes first. So what we do is we both secretly bid oil.
Oh, so oil is like your...
It's your turn order thing. So we're both going to secretly bid oil. And even if you lose the bid, you lose the oil. And that determines turn order in this game. Now, China is never allowed to have oil. There's like rules like that, which I know isn't in this scenario. They would never be able to... They're basically going last all the time.
But do you gain like your 6 oil back every turn?
Yeah, so there's a resource production phase in the game. And you can see here, there's the direct national economy where we tally resource income and then we gather resources from our territory cards. So that's the very first phase of the game. And so I don't know if we've already done that. I got to check that still. Like,
because if I gain if I gain 6 oil back every
so game, you
I
might could, even gain 6 more and when we start the game with 12, right?
I or, could put 6 oil on my bid and you only having 4, I could go first every single time.
Right, and strategically you only need to do 5 because you already outbid me with 5. So yes, you can basically guarantee that you'll win every time until I take Caucasus, of course.
No, you ain't.
So I know we're getting a little bit of rules, but I hope folks don't mind.
Where even is your oil? Like right here.
Yes, and so you can look on the board to see where the oil is. And if you don't like doing it that way, you can always ask to look at someone's cards. Because you can see the oil here. So, for example, I have 2 and 2. So my oil is in Greater Germany and Poland.
Have fun,
and then
comrade.
Belarus and Finland. And then you have a whole bunch. So, okay. The next thing you need to do for setup is you need to have your morale board set to the correct side. And I have to admit, it took me a long time to figure this out. But the thing you're looking for is right here. Let me lift it up. Under stress, these are the keywords you're looking for. If you're doing the global scenario or the Eastern Front, which we are, this is the correct side. You flip it over if
you're doing anything.
You're doing Europe and Pacific. So it's a different, the thresholds are different. And there was something on the table there. So so that's your morale board. And the general idea of how morale works is you're gonna, you have stress thresholds and you gain stress based on casualties. And then here you can see at the very top there, there's a casualty to stress conversion chart. So as you gain casualties, you're going to gain stress. And you can see over here that China, for example, which is the gold star, has a stress threshold of 4, which is pretty poor. And then, of course, Russia and the United Kingdom is a little bit higher. Japan is the highest, you know, because they fight to the death and so forth. And I'm still, like I said, we haven't, we're learned, this is a learning game for us. But basically, when they hit certain stress thresholds, I think whenever they exceed that stress threshold, what happens is, so these square nationality, remember these are the black ones, you put a nationality sticker on them, and then they start here in the white start space, and that's called acceptable stress. And then these two circles are used for turn order, okay? As they gain stress, they're gonna move along to, like this one here is civil unrest, and then it goes to dysfunctional infrastructure and so forth. And it progressively gets to the point where units start deserting and mass desertions and whatnot. So countries are going to basically fall apart as it goes. So, if I open this up again, you can see here that in addition to all the movement values, you can see these are the morale penalties. So as the morale gets lower, so blue is that blue chart there. So the labor and civil unrest. Here you lose 3 resources of any type. And it keeps going, you know, for yellow, you lose the ability to use railroads, which is something else in the game. So here you can see there are railroads. And it does do a good job of explaining. I think it explains rails here. You get to move unlimited on railroads, but you're not allowed to... obviously, the unlimited is only in territory you control. The very moment that you're passing through territory somebody else controls, you can't move along the rails anymore. And there's like rules, like, for example, you can't invade using railroads. So you can't like move from France all the way to Russia and say, I'm invading. You know, you can't do that. You're not allowed to enter enemy territory with railroads ever. But railroads are a nice way to get your troops from one end of your empire to the other. That is definitely doable. Okay, so also with this particular scenario being Russia versus Germany, we're really not going to do much with the naval units. And so that does ease us a little bit. And they give you 2 of these giant combat charts. They're double-sided, and they both have the same sides. But what they are is, like, this side here is for naval combat with air units. And then the other side is for ground combat with air units. And the reason they gave us 2 is if we have enough table space, we could literally just put them side by side and then have 1 for each. But for our case, I'm pretty sure we're going to get away with most of our battles just having the land combat alone. We don't need the naval. Although, I did notice Russia has that, what, 1 submarine up there?
And a cruiser.
And then we have a submarine and 2 cruisers. The submarines are yellow and the cruisers are blue here. So I'm ready. I'm ready to take you down. No. Naval combat. Okay, so that's the idea. And then inside of this player board, I just wanted to show there's, you know, little compartments for you to keep your units and whatnot. These aren't technically supposed to be in here. They have their own storage, but we were setting it up for global war, like I said, and this is actually what I would start with if I was doing the global. And then these are the extra commands. Did I miss anything, Jason? I mean, that's pretty much the setup. It's not, I mean, it was very time consuming because of the stickers. So when you do your first playthrough, those stickers take a while to peel off and to just put on. And then, of course, you have to get them on perfectly or otherwise they overlap too much. The stickers were an issue. Actually, to be honest, that was the biggest issue. And then, of course, just looking at the different starts and making sure we had the right number of units of everything. So... that's it. We're 28 minutes in. I think that's a decent setup. Obviously, with the global war, the setup is just going to be massive, right? We're going to have setup all across the board. The game rules did say that there's one and only one space in all of the map that's going to start basically in conflict. And gosh darn it, it's somewhere in Asia, but I can't remember what the rules said. It's definitely not our scenario, let's put it that way. There is this concept of, so for example, if we're gonna have a battle, I would put this here to show that a battle's occurring, but it's possible that a battle will pause and then we're gonna move on to the next turn. And then what you would have is you would have this situation where it's like ravaged. And so when it's ravaged, I'm just pointing this kind of stuff out now. So your card flips over, and then you have the red stripe side, and the red stripe side has less resources. So when it's in the middle of being war-torn, or I think that's the term, ravaged. So when it's in the middle of a battle, you won't be able to do as much production out of that location. And that makes sense. They got a nice player aid talking about the phases of the game. They got another one that just goes over combat. And I think we're good to go. And then, of course, the back just shows you all the locations. And we talked about that a little bit in the unboxing. So, yes. This is War Room. Setup is done. I think I need to review a few more rules before I'm ready to record actual playthrough. But I'm going to go ahead and finish this and say thank you for watching. And Jason, what else?
Stay awesome.
Stay awesome. Exactly. And so please do that. And then Jason and I are going to talk about the rules and make sure we understand what we're supposed to do in our first turn here. And we're going to get cracking Russia versus Germany War Room. So thanks for watching.